Thanks to Brilliant.org for supporting this whole week of SciShow. Go to Brilliant.org/SciShow to learn more. When we hear the term symbiosis, we tend to think about a partnership, like bees and flowers. The bees get nectar, the flowers get pollinated. It's a biological win-win. But when we dive into the science of symbioses, it turns out there are a couple of caveats. First off, though the term symbiosis is usually thought of as good for everyone, technically it just means a close ecological relationship. It can be an everyone wins type situation or a mutualism, but it definitely doesn't have to be. For example, parasitism is also a symbiosis, and so is commensalism, where one side is unaffected by the relationship. Also, and more importantly for this episode, in many cases there are more than two parties involved, and things get really interesting when you look at symbiotic three-ways. Take lichens, for instance. Often seen growing on rocks or trees, lichens are one of the classic examples of symbiosis. For 140 years, we've known that they contain both a fungus and a photosynthetic partner, like algae or bacteria, sometimes both. But in 2016, a team of scientists announced that they'd found a new partner in the mix. They were looking at messenger RNA, the chemical scripts which dictate protein synthesis, from beard-like lichens. The idea was to sequence those and then work backwards to pin them to the different branches of the tree of life they came from. You see, there had been some hints in previous studies that researchers were missing something about lichens. For instance, when they tried to grow them in sterile labs, they didn't really look right, even when both the fungus and algae were present. In particular, a part called the cortex, a structural layer which helps transfer nutrients and water, often didn't form as expected. Some researchers suggested that it could be because there was yet another partner in the mix, something missing from those sterile environments, so the scientists hoped looking at the messenger RNA could help them find it. A lot of what they got seemed to belong to the expected partners, but a few results suggested there was another fungus present. Upon further investigation, they decided it was probably a yeast. So they took to the microscope, and sure enough, they found teeny tiny cells inside the lichen. And when they checked with other scientists, it turned out that lichens all around the world also have this yeasty partner. And the yeast is found in the cortex, that nutrient-transferring structure that was so hard to grow in the lab. It might even help build it. It may also help produce compounds like vulpinic acid, a greenish-yellow toxic pigment that may help protect the photosynthetic microbes living inside the lichen from radiation. And the story doesn't end there. In 2019, scientists found another yeast that may be a natural component in some lichens, making them a symbiotic four-way. But for another example of a symbiotic trio, let's look at panic grass. Panic grasses are common throughout the world, but one especially hardy type grows near the hot springs in Yellowstone National Park, where soil temperatures can get up to 50 degrees Celsius or more. We've known for some time that this heat-tolerant panic grass has a fungal partner, and if you break up that partnership, the grass loses its ability to grow in such hot soils. But it turns out this extreme heat resistance isn't wholly from the fungus. It's thanks to a third symbiotic partner, a virus. Scientists were investigating this grass back in the late 2000s. They wanted to know how viruses might affect plant-fungus mutualisms, so they used a technique to look for viral genetic material inside the fungus. They detected an unknown virus infecting the fungus and singled it out. Normally, we'd think of a viral infection as a bad thing, but in this case, it actually seems to be an important part of the mutualistic relationship between the plant and its fungus. When scientists cured the fungus of its infection and then put the newly virus-free plants in two-week-long heat tolerance tests, they shriveled and died, while the still infected plants did just fine. And when the fungus was reinfected, the plants regained their heat resistance. The scientists weren't quite able to figure out how this works, but they said that it seems like the virus somehow affects the plant's stress response system, maybe by helping the fungus eliminate damaging chemicals generated by the plant's defense mechanism. So those are some examples of symbioses where everyone benefits from the relationship. But remember how symbioses can be a lot more complicated? Well, consider Bryopsis, a kind of marine algae, and their weird relationship with certain bacteria and voracious inch-long sea slugs. Bryopsis grows in the Pacific in places like Hawaii, and both it and its predator, a kind of sea slug, use chemicals called cahalalides to defend themselves. The slugs get these cahalalides from eating the algae, but it turns out that the algae gets them from somewhere else too. Specifically, symbiotic bacteria. These bacteria are found exclusively inside the algae, where they synthesize the algae's toxic defenses from compounds they get from their hosts. These bacteria are so specialized that they can't live on their own, and about a quarter of all their messenger RNAs, those protein scripts we mentioned earlier, are dedicated to cahalalide synthesis. The cahalalides they produce would normally keep the algae safe, but the slugs have evolved an immunity to their effects. In fact, they actually hijack these molecules for their own defenses, as well well as the algae's chloroplast. So by eating these algae, the little grazers can transform themselves from unassuming mollusks into toxic solar-powered slugs. Life is beautiful, man. And even though the bacteria and algae don't really benefit from this because they die, they're so closely linked to the slugs that it's still considered a symbiosis. The fact is, life is built on relationships and on webs of relationships, and these aren't even the most complex ones around. The gardens of fungus-growing ants may have 5 symbionts, and even humans have symbiotic relationships with the myriad of species in our guts. So symbiosis is complicated. It's not limited to 2 organisms, and not everybody wins, which makes this all endlessly fascinating. And speaking of things that are endlessly fascinating, have you checked out Brilliant.org lately? Brilliant is a problem-solving website and an app with a hands-on approach. They have over 50 interactive courses on topics in science, math, and engineering, and they're adding new ones all the time. For example, you might enjoy their new scientific thinking course. It teaches the fundamentals of physics by having you solve puzzles. And who doesn't like a puzzle? And if you really like puzzles, you'll love their daily challenges too. There are multiple new challenge questions every day, and they cover everything from statistics to electricity. You can see today's challenges for free, but when you sign up for a premium subscription, you get access to their entire database of daily challenges, as well as all of their courses. And if you're one of the first 200 people to sign up at brilliant.org/scishow, you'll get 20% off of the annual premium subscription. And you'll be supporting SciShow, so thanks for doing that.